Black Horse Regiment, the 11th Armored Cavalry Regiment, brought a new look to Vietnam. The natural barriers and unfriendly terrain in Vietnam make it tough for today's modern machines of war. But surprisingly, American mechanized units have surmounted these obstacles through ingenuity and sheer determination. And it takes determination, especially when you can't see what's ahead, even 10 feet away. A jungle might seem like a strange place for armored vehicles that can cover hundreds of miles per day in open country. Yet when the enemy can be anywhere, armor means a lot to the foot soldier. Armor helps the soldier beat a path. Armor means firepower, that extra wallop that keeps the enemy from concentrating his forces. Today's mechanized cavalry means mobility and speed, a prime requirement of modern warfare. Since their arrival in Vietnam, the cavalry troopers of the Black Horse Regiment have built a proud record of accomplishment while fulfilling their military missions. Under unique battlefield conditions never before encountered by mechanized ground forces, they built a record of leadership, of ingenuity, spirit, and valor that will always live in the annals of the 11th Armored Cavalry in Vietnam. New ways to do old jobs had to be found, and these men were equal to the task. The Third Corps area where the regiment was assigned contains the capital of South Vietnam, Saigon, important cities such as Binh Hoa and the Rice Bowl provinces. It also included strategic areas such as the Elephant's Ear and the trackless jungles of the Cambodian border. As an independent force in this vital area, the 11th Armored Cavalry gave needed support to elements of U.S. and Allied forces. Immediately after arrival at the port of Vung Tau in September 1966, the regiment moved to the important headquarters base of Long Binh for staging. Then, onward to Xuan Loc and the creation of its own base camp. The regiment was welcomed by General Creighton Abrams, later commander of all U.S. forces in Vietnam. He discussed equipment and organization with Colonel Cobb, the regiment's first commander in Vietnam. At the conclusion of his welcoming visit, General Abrams was impressed with this vital new fighting team. The familiar armored personnel carriers had been beefed up for the counterinsurgency mission in Vietnam. Each vehicle was fitted with two additional machine guns, and modification of armor gave crewmen greater protection. The crew of five men included the vehicle commander, driver, grenadier, and gunners. The result was the Armored CAV Assault Vehicle, or ACAV, the key vehicle of the new light armored platoons. After it had been proved in combat, the ACAV was soon employed in other units throughout Vietnam. Heavier armor, typified by the M48 tank, provided each squadron with a big punch. The newest armored vehicle with the 11th is the Sheridan. It mounts a 152mm gun, which also launches the Shillelagh missile. Okay. Self-propelled artillery was also part of the squadrons and was assigned to individual units in whatever mix the commander required. In the days ahead, artillery support would prove to be a valuable asset. At first, the 11th Armored Cavalry Regiment was equipped with self-propelled 105mm howitzers. Later, these were to be replaced by 155mm howitzers, which have greater range. The regiment became a completely mobile reconnaissance and striking force. They became the only freewheeling armored unit of its kind in combat in Vietnam. Within its squadrons were custom vehicles and special purpose weapons, such as heavy mortars capable of devastating fire, and highly trained mobile advisory scouts. A ThunderHorse troop of air cavalry. Within 3 weeks of arrival, units of the 11th had met the enemy, beginning with a fight for the regiment's line of communication. The Viet Cong had plenty of warning as the long lines of armor rolled down the roads and into the northern sector of the core area. Friendly observers reported the enemy was rising to the bait, preparing ambushes. In Operation Atlanta, the men of the 11th routed the ambushes with overwhelming firepower, taking a heavy toll in enemy dead and captured. Many of the enemy's weapons were seized. Best of all, the Viet Cong learned respect for the regiment at the outset. People of Lan Can province were free again. This initial success made the task easier. As the Black Horse base camp began to grow, its resupply and security gained importance. Headquarters became a hub of activity. Everywhere the camp was being developed into a comfortable main base, even though a large part remained under canvas. Communications were an important reason for the camp's existence. Powerful electronics equipment at the Tactical Operations Center allowed full communications with higher headquarters at Long Binh, and with field units which had mobile armored command posts. When in position, these field units were made secure against enemy night raids. Concertina wire encircled the area. During daylight hours, these forward outposts were busy centers of planning and direction. In all, this communications network proved an outstanding support for the troopers in the field. Fanning out from the base, armored convoys patrolled the area and protected vital supply lines as they kept the roads open. Often an armored patrol guarded an important junction or other strategic point. After long hours of patrolling far from their base, men and vehicles would pull off the road to rest. During these short periods of respite, however, the alert troopers never wandered very far from their vehicles. Purely and simply, this was enemy country. For days at a time, they were on duty 24 hours a day.